You're listening to the Mobcast Network.
Welcome, my friends, to the Catacombs, the deep underground lair where we keep the really weird stuff at the cult movie cantina. I'm your Native American pop culture spirit guide, Scotty, and I'm joined by my co-host,
Drew.
You can check us out on our website at scottywhite.com and join the discussion at the Cult Movie Cantina's Facebook page, facebook.com/cultmoviecantina. While you're discussing if Rise of Skywalker is good and while trying to explain what impeachment actually means, you can actually stop by and say hi to us. We'd love to hear from you, and don't be afraid to follow us.
Great one. Love it.
This week, we take a look at the 1993 crime thriller Judgement Night. We're going to listen to the trailer now.
Nobody is taking dates. It's a bunch of guys going to a boxing match. That's it. Why are you looking at me like that?
Because I know your friends. They have the hormones of high school kids.
I'll be home early, okay?
Promise.
What do you say, fight fans?
A night out on the town. Yeah. A heavy traffic jam.
Tell you something, I'm not going to miss this fight.
And one wrong turn.
We've circled this block about 300 times.
Yeah, enough of this scenic route. Ah! What the hell was that?
Ah! Been shot.
They're coming after me.
You gotta get me out of here. Back
off. We can't just sit here. Come on.
They got guns, John.
You broke rule number one. Do not steal from me. Oh, boys, rule number two, no witnesses.
Come on! Come on! Oh, go, go, go!
Where the hell are we?
What are we gonna do?
What do you think of the neighborhood?
The cops are going to be here any second.
The cops are not coming.
What's up? You punks crazy or something, man?
Chill out, man. We're just looking for some citizens.
Don't move. Don't whisper. Don't even breathe.
These guys don't give up.
Oh, Frank, is this your wife, huh?
I got a wife and a little girl, and I will get back to them tonight.
Let's show these punks what we got.
You better believe it.
You're just another victim. You're just another victim, kid.
Hey!
You're just another victim.
Emilio Estevez, Cuba Gooding Jr., Dennis Leary.
You know, Frank, after I kill you, I think I'm going to pay a little visit on that wife of yours.
Judgment Night.
You coming?
We could also listen to the soundtrack. We'll talk about that later.
So, Judgment Night. Drew picked this one. What is your memories from this movie?
So I saw it in the theater.
Did you?
Yeah, I did. I saw it in the theater with my best friend, Tony, Nick Najati.
Shout out to Tony.
Tony Nick, or Nike Jedi is Nike what we called him because he couldn't spell his last name. Anyway, so Tony and I saw that in the theater because we both had the soundtrack, and the soundtrack is epic.
Right.
This is the birth of rap rock, by the way.
It's true.
It's from this stupid album that Limp Bizkit and all those other knuckle turds that followed were born. And it's because I was a big Helmet fan, and you have Helmet and House of Pain doing Just Another Victim.
Right.
Still a good song.
Really great song, yeah.
And so that soundtrack led us into it. We saw it in the theater and kind of went down that path. Never gave it much mind. Movie was okay. I remember seeing it when I was... Because I didn't relate. I was 90... Let's see. It was in 93, so I was probably... 15.
Right.
So I didn't relate to that. I was the kids at the ghetto more than I was the heroes of the story.
I saw it on video probably not until probably 96. And that's the last time I saw it until I saw it for this podcast. Oh, I have thoughts.
It's interesting because I'll be curious to see what you have to say.
So directed by Stephen Hopkins, who directed Predator 2, Nightmare on Elm Street 5, The Dream Child, and he won an Emmy for doing the TV film Life and Death of Peter Sellers. Screenplay by Lewis Kolick, who did October Sky and Ladder 49, but the stories by Jerry Cunningham, who did a couple of things. I found Boss of Bosses and The Big Heist. They're both television movies. He didn't do a lot. Cinematography by Pete Levy, who also worked with Stephen Hopkins a lot. He did Predator 2, Lost in Space, Broken Arrow, your favorite, Cutthroat Island.
Hey, I was about to tell you, there's a reference to Cutthroat Island from the DP.
Yeah, I got you. You know I got you covered. edited by Tim Welburn, who directed, who edited Mad Max, The Road Warrior. And,
yeah, which is interesting.
And also the 1987 version of The Punisher with Dolph Lundgren.
Which I like.
What I really want to talk about, though, is the music. Music by Alan Silvestri. Alan Silvestri has done a lot of stuff. I'm just going to highlight some of our favorites. They're going to be a lot. Ready? Predator, Predator 2, which will come up again in this movie. Avenger Infinity War Endgame. Volcano, which I love. This will probably end up on this show. The Quick and the Dead.
Also good.
Also, to connect to our last episode of Demon Knight, he did like 10 episodes of Tales from the Crypt. He was the music. He did the music for Who Framed Roger Rabbit, Mac and Me, My Stepmother's an Alien, Flight of the Navigator, The Delta Force, all three Back of the Futures, and Romancing the Stone.
Yeah, he's epic.
He's done a lot of stuff. And then he did this movie. I have notes about that, too. Stars Emilio Estevez as Frank. We know Emilio from Young Guns, Young Guns 2, Maximum Overdrive, St. Elmo's Fire, The Breakfast Club, and, of course, The Mighty Ducks. Cuba Gooding Jr. as Mike. We know him from his Oscar-winning role in Jerry Maguire. This Show me the money!
Pre-Jerry Maguire, of course.
Is by 3 years, I think. Men of Honor, Radio, Radio just passed away. Boys in the Hood, and American Crime Story, where he played O.J. Simpson for FX. Dennis Leary, playing Dennis Leary as Fallon.
Yeah, that's really, yeah.
This is Dennis Leary in his...
90s Dennis Leary.
Playing
yeah. A.A. Dennis Leary. Right. Yeah.
So, The Sandlot, The Ref, Demolition Man, and of course, all this basically comes out of from his routine from No Cure from Cancer. Stephen Dorff as John. We know Stephen from Blade. One of my favorite movies of all time, Backbeat.
Oh, wow. That's an obscure reference.
Yeah, no one... another one of my favorite... I was going through the list and realized there's like... two Stephen Dorff movies I absolutely love. The first one's Backbeat, which I'm a Beatles fan, so it's a Beatles story, and it's about John Lennon's relationship with the first bassist of the Beatles, Steve Radcliffe, and Stephen Dorff plays Stu, and it's amazing. And then he plays in this great movie called SFW.
Oh, dude, I love that movie.
The SFW is going to be on the show.
It's a great film.
It's a great movie.
At least by memory standards.
I think it still holds up.
Yeah.
We'll see. But it's on the list. It's going to go next year, 2020, we'll be doing SFW. And then most recently, he was in True Detective Season 3, and he's amazing in it.
Yeah, he's a good actor there.
He's amazing in that. We have Jeremy Piven as Ray. I'm just going to name some fun stuff for Jeremy Piven. One of my favorites, he's in briefly in One Crazy Summer.
Yep.
He's in briefly in Singles. He's Ari in Entourage, and he's in Gross Point Blank.
10 years, man. Yep. 10 years.
Peter Green as Sykes. Peter Green is that guy who's everyone's henchman.
Good though.
Yeah, he's Zed in Pulp Fiction. He's in Redman, or is it Red something? Redbird and Usual Suspects.
Yes.
And then, did you ever watch the Black Donnellys?
I never watched it, but I know the show.
So yeah. The Black Donnellys, you can actually watch it on the NBC app. It's amazing, and you get mad when it's only one season. People don't give television a lot of respect. So,
also, one of the other thugs is you. Do you go over that?
No, that's all.
That is Everlast.
Oh yeah.
From House of Pain.
House of Pain.
Pre-solo career.
Yeah,
it's got to be a little raspy.
He does a really good cover of Sex and Candy that he did on like Joe Rogan, I think, or something. That
he's was fun. Cool.
All right, ready to get into this?
Yes.
So, came up to the laneway the other day. Sorry, we're on a Letterkenny bit and kicking, so if you're not, go find clips on YouTube and then go watch it on Hulu. It's really, really good.
Pitter-patter.
Yeah, pitter-patter. Let's get at her. So meet Frank. He's a dude with a new baby who's totally needs to get away from his wife, but she's upset because, you know, she's stuck with a baby too. So the true moral of the story is babies ruin everything.
You know, it's weird. Again, seeing it 15, no idea what any of this means.
Right.
Now as a dad, adult, human male that has a child in the same boat, you're like, oh, yeah, I totally get this. And he's really kind of treating his wife like shit. I mean, it's poor. But she's also being a kind of a butthole herself.
Right. She's like, baby, you can just watch.
That's what babies really do. They destroy, like, the beauty of it until it comes back.
Again, the true moral of the story is babies ruin everything.
Only problem I got is that baby, she says, is 3 weeks old. That kid is like, kid's like a good 4, 5, 6 months.
It's a giant child. Anywho, it's a giant child. Frank's having a night out with the boys. Mike, his tough and cool black friend, who is all, show me the money, before that was a thing. Then there's Ray, who's like, Paul Giamatti was a stockbroker. Wait, isn't that Billions? That's on Showtime. Wait, no, anyway, more dickish.
Facts.
That's true. Man, Jerry Pimmer is totally doing Paul Giamatti before Paul Giamatti was a thing. I think Paul Giamatti stole his old bit from this movie.
Yep.
But Ray got a hookup and got an RV, and so he's going to take his boy in style to a boxing match. Oh, and look, Frank's brother, screw up, brother John's going to come because, well, you need that, right? So there's drinking and a taffer jam, and you get a giant RV through that stuff, and one bad decision leads to another, and the group goes to a shady part of town where it totally needs a rap version of Dueling Banjos because this is Deliverance in the inner city instead of Georgia. This movie is Deliverance.
It is 100%.
100% Deliverance. Yeah. So I watched Deliverance and went, we can put this in Chicago. Yep. And that's what they did. Then they think they hit a guy. Turns out he was shot and then on the run. And while things get worse, the RV gets smashed and blown up. Dennis Leary, who will be, who's named Fallon, but for the rest of this summer, we're just going to call Dennis Leary because that's who he is. Dennis Leary and his goons get the guy that was hit, shoot him, and now because he's got to shoot the boys because there's a no witnesses policy.
Well, Dennis, in fairness, Dennis Leary has rules, and he follows these rules meticulously.
Oh, I have
like to his own detriment.
I have after the summary, I have lots of thoughts.
Yeah.
No witnesses policy, and so he takes chase. The boys lead him to a railroad station where they do their best hobo impression, and it doesn't go well. While hiding in the streetcar, some bums are using homeless shelters. The bums totally need payment, or they're going to give them up. Things get loud. Leary and his goons go all shooty-shooty and kill the wrong dudes, but Leary gets Frank's wallet, and now he knows who he's looking for. Poor Emilio. Frank and the boys head to an apartment building where no one wants to help them because Candyman or something. It's all in Chicago. It's all pretty much near
convenience. That was a good reference. I liked it.
They can't find a phone to use, but they convince one lady barely to let them hold up in her place, and, well, that is not going well. Leary's all, come out, wherever you are, and the project folks want to give him up. The lady tells the boys there's an escape route that the kids take on the roof, and they go up there. So, yeah, the escape route is sort of like some ladders turned into a bridge, and that's not the best option, but it's their only option, except for Ray, who's going to stay and negotiate because, well, he's scared of heights, and, he's kind of a dick. So he goes to negotiate with Leary and his goons offering money, and, yeah, well, that ends with him being thrown off the building. Because Leary. Now four boys turn to three as they're chasing the sewers. Mike is all like, show me the money. Wait, no. He's like, no, let's take a stand. So the three guys arm themselves with pipes and other things that you find in movie sewers. Leary's guys show up. There's a fight with Mike killing one of Leary's while carrying Peter Green. The boys escape. Another goon complains like, he didn't sign up for this shit. And so Leary kills him because reasons. Because rules, I guess. He didn't like whining, is what he says.
Yeah, that's one of his rules, no whining.
Meanwhile, Mike berates John for almost getting killed back in the sewer. He didn't have his back like he said he would. He froze, and that's why Frank had to seduce Sykes. Frank comes to his little brother's defense, and Mike backs down, calls him boss. They take refuge in an abandoned building. John cries that he's scared. Frank tries to console him. Mike just looks from afar. They proceed to call the Frank boss again and said that the street's clear. Frank tells Mike it's cool it with the boss stuff because they're bitchy. They're so bitchy in this. They see a bus try to flag down the driver, but they refuse to stop. Mike shoots at the bus. That doesn't make the bus stop. Frank tells him to stop because, well, they're going to get killed. There's a fight. Frank punches Mike, blah, blah, blah. Frank's like, I'm just going back to my wife and kid, which you should have done from the beginning of this, but whatever. Now, the threesome break into a swap meet, hoping to summon the police by setting off the building's alarm. This brings in two security guys who think they're home free. One goes to turn off the alarm and call the cops, but then he meets by Dennis Leary, who kills them. Other lieutenant proceeds to kill the second security guy. In a game of cat and mouse, Leary's goon wounds Mike, not before Mike gets shut off himself. Rhodes tries to... the goon tries to finish Mike off.
Yeah, it's a guy from House of Pain.
Yeah, House of Pain.
Edge, tries, yeah, or Edge. Whatever his name is.
Well, it was proves to be too much, and he falls and dies. John retrieves Mike, but Leary shoots John in the leg. The three make their way to the bathroom where Frank tries to patch up his brother and his friend. Frank leaves to get help, but encourages Dennis Leary. Frank and Dennis Leary have a fight, but yay, look, Frank wins and throws Dennis Leary off the ledge of some staircase, and he dies. It's too late to do any good now. The police arrive. Mike and John are rushed to the hospital. Frank leaves, retrieves his wallet from police officer, who comments that you got a good-looking family. Credits.
There you go.
Oh.
Look, I on second view, I actually liked it. It's just a different... There are moments of tension in that I thought were very well constructed for me. Like, it totally worked for me.
Okay. I mean, that's fine. Yeah. I watched what I thought was a poor version of Deliverance. There's, to me, it wasn't like tension. It was just like, it was just a whole bunch of just bad decisions that you're just like, I didn't feel bad for these. Like, anytime anything happened, I didn't really feel bad for anybody.
I felt bad for Frank most of the time just because he's in a situation that.
Yeah, but he's a dick to his wife. And it's like, yeah, you put yourself in this situation.
Yeah, but I guess I projected more into it. I related more to that character group.
That's
and,
fair.
And being in that situation more. And it's just like driving over here. I drive past a pretty rough neighborhood, and it's constantly in the back of my mind, like, I don't want to, like, break down in this spot. It's not a safe zone. I don't feel comfortable in this. So to me, it was the projection of tension that led into it. It's shot extremely well. It's visually, to me, gritty as all get out.
That's very gritty. Yeah.
The nighttime shadows still play right. So you're not getting like overly lit stuff like a cheap movie might be. It's not too dark in some spots where you lose detail. It just works. The sewer is a build, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, it's a build. Yep.
That's a whole. Is that going to be a fact?
No. It's a build.
That's a big stage build.
Because this movie is filmed both in Chicago and in L.A.
And they shot in real locations.
Yeah, shot in real locations.
Like real dangerous locations.
Right. I've got notes about that, too.
Great.
I got some trivia about that.
Oh, awesome. Emilio Estevez, though, as a hero, I don't buy it. I don't even buy it in Young Guns. I've never bought it.
Really? I like
it. Yeah, Minute Work. That's the movie I'll give him it to, man.
I like
Emilio. Keith David.
I've always liked him as Billy the Kid. I liked him as who was he in Maximum Overdrive?
I don't remember his character name. He was a hero, though.
Yeah, he was a hero in that.
Yeah. He was the driver of the clown truck.
He worked at the
gas station.
The truck stop. The truck stop, yeah. Because he's on probation and stuff.
Yeah.
That's why they got him.
What happened to him, though? Where has he been?
I don't know.
I don't think he does movies, though.
Oh, he just did one recently.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I did one about homeless people in the library or something.
Oh.
Looking out this year, yeah.
Yeah, no idea.
I don't think he has to. I mean, he's got Young Guns movie, plus, you know, Charlie.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, he's enough. Estevez is a sheen. He's got, like, there's a whole family of stuff going on.
Yeah.
I mean, what he really needs to do is make a movie with Joe.
I know.
Yeah, Joe and Emilio Estevez making a movie together?
I'd be all about it.
I haven't seen Joe in a while.
Nope, haven't seen him in a while. Not since Soul Taker.
Oh, it's going to be on this show.
Shot here in Mobile, Alabama.
I bet we could call him in. He probably might show up and talk about it.
Yep.
If I offer him enough money, that'd be good. You might can use it.
I might find us someone who has ties to Soul Taker.
Oh, that would be awesome if you could.
All right, I'll see what I can do.
I would love to talk about that. You know, outside of, I mean, it really is a Deliverance ripoff. I mean, like, real bad.
No, 100%.
100%. Like, and
there's just no, like, pig fudging.
No, there's no pig fudging, which, you know, takes away from it. Important. There's no Ned Beatty to really do anything to. Does it work? It does, I guess. I'm not. I don't feel a lot of it. I don't like Cuba Gooding Jr. is kind of a token character in this anyway, and so he's like, I need to be black when I need to be black, and I need to be like, I'm the tough guy, and he's not really.
Oh, there's definite character inconsistencies that show up throughout.
And like,
actually, Stephen Dorff is pretty consistent.
Well,
yeah.
No, he's not, because he shows up. He's all this tough, like, bad, like, reputation boy, and then he turns out.
Oh, but I always read it as it was just puffed ego.
You think so?
Yeah. That's how I read it.
I just always thought he was
like Frank was actually the only one that had the balls to do anything.
Right, but he just seemed like he was like a troublemaker. Like, yeah. Maybe he was. I don't know. I like Paul Giamatti Ray.
Oh, Jeremy Piven's fantastic in this.
Piven's really good in it.
And I think Dennis Leary's good because it's Dennis Leary from that time frame. Like, right. He had done two or three movies before this.
Yeah,
two
I
movies?
Think he did Demolition Man in a row. Oh, Demolition Man was coming out, and because Demolition Man is 1994.
Because he's much better in The Ref. He's way better in The Ref.
But he's also still doing all that material. It's the same material he's doing. I mean, it's No Cure for Cancer, pretty much. And
oh, I love it,
and
though.
That's Bill Hicks' bit anyway. So
it is.
So.
It's
I mean, 100%. We can really get into that.
Oh, so. No, it's 100% a ripoff of it. But at some reason, it just worked. Dennis Leary's a little more, I don't know, he just fits the look.
No. I loved, like, No Cure for Cancer was really big for me in high school.
Yeah.
I mean, I still listen to it from time to time. It's still, you know, NyQuil, 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 I love you, you giant fucking Q. It's one of the funniest shit ever. Yeah. And if you're not listening to it, go back. It's on Amazon Prime. Listen to it. You can listen.
It's bizarro. It's edgy.
It's 90s edgy. And so if you're a certain age, you won't get the references. But it's like, I mean, it's funny. It's like diehard funny.
Yeah.
But it's let's be honest, is mostly ripped off from Bill Hicks stuff. And so, you know, but I've went back and listened to Bill Hicks's versions of that, and I like Dennis Leary's better. I know it's
right. Something about Dennis Leary's delivery of lines is what's great.
Right.
It changes.
Right.
Rescue Me, by the time you get to Rescue Me with Dennis Leary, he's a normal actor.
Right. And so that's when Lock and Loaded, the follow-up came out about the same time, and Lock and Loaded is not nearly as good as No Cure for Cancer.
It's something about the cadence in which he talks. And so it works inside of this. I don't even think he's from Chicago. He's a Boston guy.
He's a Boston guy. Yeah, he's a Boston guy.
But it works inside of this movie. The only problem I have with this is, like, Dennis Leary, what business does he run? I mean, he's just a criminal, right?
He's a crime lord of some sort.
Yeah, but, like, nobody knows who he is. So, like, when he goes to the urban side and there's a bunch of, like, gangster kids,
right,
like, they're like, I don't respect you. I would have preferred him to be like, where is he? You know, like, he didn't need to talk his way into it. He's Dennis Leary. He's this evil sumbitch. He kills his own people. Do you think that couple, by the way, was gay?
In the housing projects?
Yeah.
No, I think they were related.
I thought it would have been a nice touch if they would have been that edgy. That's really progressive for 1992. 93 or 92?
It released in 93, so they filmed it in 92. So I think it was
very progressive.
I don't think it would be too progressive. I don't think they would do it.
Yeah.
So much more. So here's the fundamental problems I have with this film. So they think they hit this kid, and he's actually been shot by Dennis Leary's crew. And Dennis Leary's crew just shows up horror film style and break into the RV. Just snatches him out of the RV. Harmony literally like a horror film.
Yep.
And then he pleads for his life, and that doesn't work, and Dennis Leary shoots him. And then he's like, yeah, now I got to kill these guys because there's no witnesses. And then he goes through a whole litany of stuff that's like bad decisions. Like, you're just going to have to kill more people if you have this no witnesses problem.
Right.
Because you're just running around town and aimlessly just committing crimes that you now no witnesses. It's like, you've got a lot of witnesses, dude. Honestly, I'd let these four guys go. You probably won't ever – they don't know who you are. And how can they – you know – poor Jerry Piven's got to figure out how he's going to explain the RV that just exploded. The best thing that happened to him was he died, so he didn't have to go back to the RV park.
Yeah, because he was in big trouble at that point. Because I don't think he really had it, right? It was just all, it was kind of a sham. Like, he kind of got it on loan.
Right, he got the RV on loan. He convinced the dealer that he needed like four or five of them.
And I forgot completely. I was like, I remember when we pre-talked about it, I was like, oh, but the problem with Judgment Night is the movie can be solved with a cell phone. And it can't be.
It can't be, no.
Because they showed it. Yeah. They fixed that problem. So it wouldn't. It would have only been solved with a smartphone.
Right.
Because you could use GPS to get you back to the interstate. Aside from that, it was the old days of a flip phone. I had that phone.
Right.
And that's one of the ones where you had to push even to send a text. It was like 26 keystrokes.
I don't think it had text back then. I think you just.
No, it didn't. It didn't. So, but that was the model I had eventually that did.
So, of course, they also have a gun because different Piven needs a gun that I don't know. I mean, it was loaded, but when I first saw it,
I don't think it was loaded.
Well,
they suggested it, but in not to be a gun nerd, but at one point the magazine is in the gun. He pulls the slide back and it locks.
Right.
And then he closes it and nothing happens and then takes them. Like, he didn't load the gun. He unloaded. It was unloaded. Right.
Cuba Gooding Jr. shot it a few times.
Yeah.
And so.
And he shot the revolver too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think the best thing that happened was Piven getting thrown off the.
I actually liked that dialogue scene. I thought it was interesting.
Oh yeah, I was like, hey, you're a businessman. I'm a businessman.
I thought it was good. It was very much Jeremy Piven. I wonder how much of that was just turning him loose, because it felt a little like there was words, but then just letting him go.
Right.
Because he pleaded well. I thought he made a good pitch.
Yeah, I mean, $200,000. You know. To these three guys, that's still going to get you thrown off the bridge. Also, Cuba Gooding Jr. can't hit anybody with a gun. So
no, he's a stormtrooper.
Yeah, he just could not. He's
definitely a stormtrooper.
He's finning it up over here.
Yeah, he's totally finning it. And then I also thought it was I think the choice to end the entire movie in a whatever that store was, that swap or whatever.
The swap meet, yeah.
Is bizarre. That's really bizarre. It's a bizarre place to end a movie.
I do like the security guards who are like, they don't give a crap about who they are, and like, these guys are clearly dudes in trouble, and they're like, nope, we're going to go almost shoot them. And like, what?
Yeah.
And then even when the cops show up, they're like really forceful with Emilio Estevez. And then they're like, oh, yeah, we found a bunch of bodies. And they're like, oh, okay, cool, that's cool. And instead of going, let's arrest this dude.
All right. They should have all been arrested.
They should all go to jail. Yeah, there's a lot going on here.
It's a statement about, you know, that world, though, because like the bus driver won't stop running that It's just that part's kind of bizarre.
So how much sex does Emilio Estevez have when he comes back home?
Yeah, no joke.
Right.
Or yeah. how much he's going to tell her the story, and then she's going to be like, you're on the couch, champ. Right. From this point forward.
I'm just saying, if it's been 3 weeks, he may be a little bit before he can touch that vagina.
No, this is science facts.
Oh, wow. So there's a handful of scenes the Jerry Piven thing I like. I think Piven's my favorite character in the whole thing. There's not a lot with Stephen Dorff. There's a little bit, especially toward the end of it, when you find out he's not as big as he says he is. Cuba Gooding Jr. is kind of wasted in this, but this is early in his career, so I mean he's earning his chops anyway.
Right.
Emilio's totally wasted. It's not a right fit for him, and there's reasons for that because they didn't want him.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, that'll come up in a little bit.
Interesting.
They didn't want him. And so
it's a big studio release. It's a Universal film.
Sort of.
Oh, interesting.
Sort of.
I like it when you dig into these magic little things that explain a lot more stuff.
We can get into it. I mean, anything else you want to say about the film itself? I mean, we've done
the soundtrack is worth listening to, and the history of the soundtrack.
We'll talk about that too. That's on here. I mean, that's what made this movie, is the soundtrack. And the soundtrack's really good. It held up. I listened to it also while I was on it.
Yeah, I drove.
The movie's extremely mediocre, and then like really just kind of like, I got through it, but it wasn't like a chore to get through. But I was like, I could have done other stuff. But yeah. I'm watching this for the. I mean, I literally like outside of the podcast, I don't think I'd watch this movie again.
I probably wouldn't I revisited it. I don't have to go back for 6 years.
I got you.
I feel good about it. I feel good about the decision because it's a cult movie. It does have a cult following. Like there's a cult around this movie, but I don't know if it's one that I would be a part of.
So I read a little bit about that because the director they had a 25th anniversary screening of it recently in Chicago.
Yep.
And he was talking about the cult following of this. I'm like, really? How big is this cult?
Right.
Because
I think it's all going to be related to the soundtrack. I think the soundtrack is driving 99% of it.
It's like for me, like I mentioned it before, but singles.
Yep.
Cameron Crowe movie.
I'm with you. 100% on this. The soundtrack trumps the movie.
Yeah, the movie's okay. It's a romantic comedy kind of thing, but it's fine what it is. The soundtrack's one of the best. I will argue it's probably the best soundtrack of the 90s. It's one of the best soundtracks ever. You know, it's got to be easily top 10.
Oh, 100%.
But like for the 90s, it's got to be number 1. I can't think of anything better that came out in the 90s that was
Like personal versus just actual album, I think singles is a better one. Right. Personally, I'm a So Married an Axe Murderer guy.
Right.
So that's my favorite soundtrack of all time. But
it's a good soundtrack. And that one's a good one too. But we're talking about on
a bigger scale. Right. Yeah. Singles wise, if you look at singles and what it is,
it
launched all kinds of crap.
It's a history of grunge before grunge had a history.
That's 100% fact.
And so
somebody broke that. Some A&R rep broke that.
Right.
Just like this, some A&R rep was like, hey, let's take these bands because we're talking 93. Helmet Meantime came out in 92,
right?
91 actually. So Helmet's still a pretty big. Mudhoney's virtually unheard of at this point.
Right. You got Pearl Jam, who's also
Sonic Youth is on the soundtrack.
Yeah, like Pearl Jam came out in 91. They were just recording Verses when this came out,
right?
And so they're teamed up with Cypress Hill, who just had Insane in the Membrane come out. And it was
the rappers were bigger than the rock stars on this scenario, with the exception of like Slayer. I think Slayer was pretty big at that time. Body Count.
Fan Club and De La Soul's Fallen is brilliant.
Oh, that song holds up so well.
Oh, yeah, because it's the first song you hear in the credits, and it's like, oh, my God, it's so good.
It's such a great track.
It samples Tom Petty, and it's just like...
It's so good.
So good. I like the the movie's okay. The soundtrack's amazing, and so...
And the downside is the movie... The one thing that I really didn't like about the movie is it did not take advantage of the soundtrack in the film. Like, it opens with Fallen, and it closes with Fallen. Great song.
But I don't think they had it.
The music became background.
Right, but I don't think they had it, right? And so
they should have had those pieces though where they plugged them in.
It had to have been an afterthought.
I don't know. They had Fallen.
Well, they had Fallen like in that part of the production. Maybe that was ready, but I don't know. Like making this movie, I don't think they had like music in mind.
No. It's not like Baby Driver scenario.
Right. Yeah.
Though had you turned this into a
right. See, and I understand how films are made. We've made films but it's like for me, though, I'm always thinking soundtrack. anyway as I'm making. I just don't have money to buy.
This could be an example of, again, where the marketing was like, yeah, the movie's all right, but we can make some money off the record.
Right, right.
And that could be where we're at.
So here's some facts. A screenwriter, Kevin Jerry, actually was one of the ones who wrote the first spec script for the movie sometime around 89.
Jeez.
Producer Lawrence Gordon, who produced the films like Predator and Die Hard, bought it in January 1990. But later his script was sold to another studio, and by the time the movie was going to be made, Jerry's original script was dramatically changed by many other writers, to the point where Lewis Kolick, one of the writers who worked on the rewrites, could only get a story get writing a story credit. According to fans of Kevin Jerry, who read the original script, not a single word from it strayed from the final film, and the script was a lot more darker and violent than the first one. I'd like to see if I can get my hands on that.
Yeah, no joke.
Same thing happened to Jerry's original script for films like Rambo First Blood Part 2 and The Devil's Own.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. After the 25th anniversary screening during Cinelocalypse in Chicago, director Stephen Hopkins confirmed that the script went through many, many changes, and many months before it got to a final. Couple writers, which Hopkins were involved in earlier, were Gary Cunningham and John Carpenter.
Really?
Yeah, Carpenter worked on it a little bit. He also said one of these versions took place in the desert outside L.A. and included biker gangs and rooftop motorcycle chases. If it's outside L.A., it's most likely Carpenter doing that stuff. So here's the thing. Emilio Estevez asked for and received $4 million to star in this film.
Good gosh.
He was able to get this much a larger payday than anyone expected because he was available at the point where the film needed to go into production or had the plug pulled. They spent more than twice that $4 million figured on pre-production, which would have been lost if he didn't take the lead role. So they didn't want him, and they passed on him, and they were trying to get these other people, and they couldn't get anyone else. And so they were like, we have to make this movie. Emilio's available. He wants $4 million. And they were like, we'll pay him $4
million. Good. That's brutal.
That's why he's not working.
Yeah.
Alan Silvestri's first score was rejected.
Wow.
The original score was entirely electronic, but the filmmaker asked if he would beef up the action in the orchestral score. Hopkins wanted a score to sound more like the one he did for Predator 2, which Hopkins also directed. And that's why there's a lot of similarities between the both scores. So at the end of this movie, it's basically the score to Predator 2.
Yeah.
Literally this. Let's see. I'm trying to find it. There are most of the scores. What are the new stuff? There's three tracks from the original on the soundtrack itself, not the soundtrack, but the score track. And some of the original music you can hear in the theatrical trailer, but the rest of it was rejected. And
that's fascinating.
But the last third of this, the music in this is Predator. I mean, it's just,
it happens. It's probably B tracks, and he just like stuff that got rejected from Predator 2. And
so during the scene where Frank is attempting to catch up with the police car, the RV passes by Patty's Pub from It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, which isn't located in Chicago or Philadelphia, but in Los Angeles.
That's so funny.
Thought you would enjoy that.
That's great.
During the film of the rooftop confrontation between Dennis Leary and Paul Giamatti / Terry Piven, the cast and crew were stunned by the sound of random unexpected gunshots. The crew ran downstairs to find a 16-year-old kid with his head blown off by another youth of the same age as part of a gang initiation by murder. The army was brought in to secure the area the next day, and production was moved elsewhere.
Good God.
During the opening weekend, there was a shooting at this screening in a Bronx theater, and local media blamed the movie itself on the incident. In response, it was quickly pulled from distribution and ran only 2 weeks. That's why it doesn't make a lot of money. This led to a failure at the box office and eventually its cult status, which I still question.
That's fast. So
it was direct to video in Europe. Also, it was not released in theaters.
Yeah, so I saw it in theaters. That's fascinating. I had no idea about the gang. But why? It doesn't really make sense that it's a gang violence movie. And the soundtrack is really not that violent. Like, listening to it, there's cuss words on the soundtrack.
Right, but it's the early 90s, and we had that. Remember, this is the scare we also had. We had The Program, where the football guy's lying, and they had that. And they're, what's the one where they burn the guy alive in the subway booth? It's the Damon Wayans movie's Bullet. I can't remember. There's another one of the 90s movies where they had an act of violence that people were trying to do. And then of course, when Juice came out, there was gunfights for Juice and stuff like that.
I remember that.
So,
it's just amazing to me because this is a very whitewashed movie.
It is. It is.
I mean, Cuba Gooding Jr. is the only... I mean, he's token in this right. film because it's 90s, and this right. is what they did. Fascinating.
Universal was also taken back by the bleak tones of the dailies shot in Chicago. They thought the crew was using a matte painting.
Wow, it's so flat. So that's flat. Amazing.
It was so flat.
See, I love the fact that it was that gritty. I thought that was a nice touch. It felt very 70s cinema to me.
I like the look of it. Don't get it. I just, again, the story to me was just like, I didn't like any of the characters, and it was like, even like Dennis Leary, I'm not rooting for him. I was like, is there a way where everyone can lose? I just,
right.
And I don't think they're, and we can get to this part. It's like, so, but you like the film, so would you?
I don't love the film. I just, it's so on my moderate scale, it's on the like side as opposed to the non-like
so
side.
How would you change it? If you were in charge of this film, what would you do?
Well, I mean, let's say, okay, so I'm remaking essentially right. in the modern scenario. I think you still make it in the city. I think you have to find a mechanic to get rid of the cell phone situation. You've got to do something. I think you actually need to lower the age group. I think it needs to be like teenagers, like 18, 19, 20, and they're going to some kind of rave or something, and this is how it happens to them, as opposed to adult, like, individuals that can make much better decisions, because that's part of the problem you're having. Part of the problem I had is these guys make decisions that are terrible. And I think they put the drinking there to kind of offset that. But if you have young people making bad decisions,
but they have the drinking, but they don't really act drunk.
No, I know. Yeah, but I'm saying
I have a huge, like,
I would take it and make it young people making bad decisions at a rave. They lose their phones. Everything goes to shit with them. And they do experience something horrific. Like, they got to see something horrific, like murder in a situation. And then suddenly, if you have younger people running through this scenario, it's a different beast. And most people aren't going to pay attention to them. So you're making a statement about the youth. The fact that we kind of don't observe the youth. We're like, oh, those dumb millennials. You kind of take that approach and you push it out that way. And then you modernize it with the same sort of soundtrack.
So to build off that, I like that.
And the soundtrack has to be integral to the movie. So it has to be cut almost like a musical.
So I like a lot of this. I would do it like, I like the idea of them going to a rave instead of a boxing. I like that hip, and I'm digging
it. Well, it works in that space,
It definitely works in that space, because you're going to a shady place to a rave anyway. I would have them all do Uber.
Oh, sick. That's cool.
And the Uber driver is the guy who's the one who's murdered.
Or even if they take an Uber, though,
yeah.
They're dropped off without a car.
Right. Exactly.
And if their phones are gone, right. There you go. Solves the problem.
Because you don't need the RV.
Actually, we could make this move.
Right. You don't need the RV.
Right.
You don't.
No, the RV's gone. It's got to be. It's just a mechanism to get them there.
Right. And it's not really a. It's like, I was thinking the RV. I'd seen it like 20 years ago almost, and I thought the RV was a bigger part of that.
I did too.
And it's not. It's like
very small.
It's like in the first act they burn it out and then they're on the run. It's like, then why spend the money on the RV? I don't.
The other thing I would do is make it winter. So cold. It sucks. I bet the production on this movie sucked.
It's all daylight.
I mean, it's all nighttime exteriors. Yeah. Screw that. And I'm sure they shot it maybe during the spring, so it wasn't so brutal. But I would make this in the winter, so you force them inside. So you're constantly and it's easy to track them because now there's footprints. Like I would do where there's snow on the ground. I would do things like that to make it a much harder. And I would make the hero a woman. I literally would pull a Ripley. I would make a Ripley out of this girl that literally you see her kind of take control of the situation. Right. The one thing I did like about the original that I would try and maintain somewhat in this is, instead of going as a horror film where everybody dies, I did like the fact that one person died and the others were injured. Maybe I make the group five and kill two, three make it.
Right.
But I would do something to some level of like, not everybody needs to get wiped off.
Of course, speaking of which, I mean, in a certain way, if like Blumhouse got a hold of this, this could be a great horror film.
It's a fantastic horror film.
There's a great idea in this. Instead of doing this crime thriller, go straight up horror with it.
Yeah.
And you don't need your Dennis Leary type doing his bits in it. I don't know.
You don't have to have that.
No, Dennis Leary kind of threw me off. I
didn't mind it. I like mouthy bad guys. That's a 90s trope. Mouthy bad guys is 100% 90s trope. So it didn't bother me so much.
Like, I just kept going, you're making things worse.
Yeah.
You're a terrible boss. You're making things way worse. Why are you doing it? We're making this is if... I'm going to fully admit that I'm going to remake Deliverance in the city. Let's just be honest. Let's make it.
Yeah.
If we're going to make it, let's make it. And like, you know, I like, you know, maybe the guys are going back to, you know, to this one spot because, you know, just like in Deliverance, this place is not going to be like this anymore. And so I'm going to go back and see home or whatever, where I came from or whatever, and things go south from there. Or the guy's like, this is where I came from. He never was there from the first place. He's got, maybe he's like some rich dude who's got this whole backstory where he's like, yeah, I come up from the inner city. And they show go, we don't fucking know you. Why are you here?
Right.
And then.
Look, I'd love it if you go ballsy and it's an Eminem or another rapper type character. And it's like, it doesn't matter white or black. I don't care. Just somebody that's a poser.
Yeah, comes in.
And, that's brutal.
And so you come in, and then the whole town's again. But see,
wait a second. Can I borrow that idea from my teenage version?
Of course you can.
Like, that's the kid that knows where the rave is and he doesn't.
Right.
And so, that's our Jeremy Piven.
But then mine turns away more away from Deliverance and becomes more Southern Comfort.
Ooh, good reference.
I love Southern Comfort over Deliverance.
Yeah.
Deliverance is what it is and I like, but for me, the better film is, I think the performances are better.
Yeah.
And you got Powers Booth and Robert Carradine, and it's just, if you've not seen
fantastic.
I need to put that on this list.
We should put it on the list.
Because it's,
we got to find it though, right?
I think you can get it digitally. I think I'll have to look. But the soundtrack's really good. Ry Cooder's done the soundtrack on it.
Yeah.
So it's like, I think Deliverance, for those who have not seen it, think Deliverance. And if you've not seen Deliverance, go YouTube that. But it's Deliverance in Louisiana with National Guard guys who are basically weekend warriors. They're on assignment, they're on a training mission or whatever. And they piss off some Cajuns. And these Cajuns are stalking them through this movie. And it's just brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant.
Yeah, it's like, brutal. It's a brutal movie.
It's just a good movie. So I would take a little Deliverance. I would take a little Southern Comfort. I would shake it up and throw it in like Chicago or Cleveland or, you know, somewhere Gary or New Orleans even. Hell, New Orleans would have been great.
New Orleans ain't bad.
Yeah. Anywhere but Mobile.
Yeah. Doesn't work here.
So as we talked about the soundtrack was really, really good. It's got Helmet and House of Pain doing Just Another Victim. We talked about Fallen from the Teenage Fan Club, De La Soul. YouTube that is so good. Me, Myself, and My Microphone by Living Color and Run DMC, which is also brilliant. And
it's good. My favorite one is who's Del the Funky Homo Sapien with?
Oh, I can't remember. I didn't write it down.
I don't either. That track, though, because, you know, most people know Del from the Gorillaz.
Right.
And so when you hear, or Gorillaz, sorry. And so when you hear it, it's actually really, it's another Teenage Fan Club. Is that right? No, Teenage Fan Club's De La Soul. Del the Funky. Sorry, I'm trying to find it. But go ahead. Continue with your bit. And I'll dig it up.
And then, of course, me being the fan, there's a Pearl Jam and Cypress Hill song, Real Thing. The Pearl Jam song part, though, is basically just Jeff Emmett, Stone Gossard, and the drummer.
Yeah, it's pretty simple riff, too.
Yeah. And they just were kind of hanging out and play, and they were that there's a lot of history on Pearl Jam, like through the fan sites and stuff. And there's like, this is like a little blip where they don't talk about it. And
yep.
I don't know if they didn't have a good, but Stone's a huge Cypress Hill fan. So it had been a treat for him anyway. And he even gets name checked in this.
Oh yeah.
He gets name checked in that. So I thought that was pretty sweet. Oh, what do you think the budget was?
Oh, I don't know. This is probably 92. It's probably fairly decent. 12?
21.
21? Good grief.
Opening weekend, what do you think it made?
Maybe that's close to 10.
4.
God, it bombed.
Total gross was 12.5.
12.5 on a 21. Never made it.
So it released October 17th, 1993. How do you think it did in the top 10? I will tell you, it did make the top 10.
Yeah, there's no way it made the top 10. It was a $4 million.
No, it made
the
top 10.
It did with the $4 million drop?
Yep.
It's got to be like 5.
You're close. Number 6.
Yeah.
Number 1, Demolition Man.
Of course. The Seashell.
Yep. Number 2, The Beverly Hillbillies.
Wow, what a turd.
It was opening weekend for that, too.
Oh, God.
Number 3 was Cool Running.
I love that movie.
I do, too. Number 4 was Malice. And then number 5
was terrible.
And with number 5 was Dazed and Confused.
Ooh. All right.
That's where we're getting Matthew McConaughey from.
Yeah, that's good.
So how do you think it ranked in the top films of 1993?
Oh, my God. It's got to be, I'm going to go with 62.
101.
Golly, it didn't even make the top hundo.
Can you name the top 5 films of 1993?
No, Jurassic Park.
Number 1, you got one.
Finally, it's taken 4 shows for me to just say Jurassic Park all the time.
You got 4 more shots. Go.
Oh my God, Ghostbusters 2? That's not in there.
No, 92, man. Or over 90.
93 Out of Africa. No?
That's 86.
I don't know. I'm terrible at dates.
You are very
terrible. I got Jurassic Park. That's the only one that matters to me.
I'll give you one more shot and then I'll let you give up.
I have no idea what else would be. What else came out? Back to Future 3? That's 89.
No. Good thinking. Number one, Jurassic Park. Number two, The Fugitive.
Oh, damn it. I knew that one.
Number three, The Firm.
Oh, I knew that too.
Sleepers in Seattle.
Ugh.
And Mrs. Doubtfire.
Oh, I knew all these. We've gone over these before.
This is the year that gave us In the Line of Fire.
Great movie.
Yeah, it is.
John Malkovich with plastic gun. That's a freaking awesome idea. Yeah, great movie.
It's a good movie. I watched it recently because it was on, Crackle. It's on Crackle.
It's a good film.
A Few Good Men.
Great film.
Also Cuba Gooding Jr. Groundhog Day.
Great film.
Aladdin.
You know.
And the Oscar winner that year was Schindler's List.
Oh, good God. I can't believe I didn't remember that. That's Spielberg.
So that was how it did.
Well, it is what it is.
It's Deliverance. It's what it is.
Yeah. No. It is what it is.
I mean, it's not Nemesis bad. Nemesis is the worst thing we've seen. So it's
Nemesis is the worst thing ever made.
I think my problem is that I expected so much more out of this cast. And even being a Deliverance ripoff, I was expecting more and I didn't get it. It's very flat. It's just like,
oh, it's a flat film. That's my one thing. It feels like an indie film more than it does a studio picture to me.
Right. And it kind of was treated that way.
And it was kind of treated. I think it was from the beginning.
Because you know, I mean, if Universal's looking at dailies and going, this is a matte painting and not going, just sending in people to help. They're just like, whatever. We've paid Emilio $4,000.
I think it just lacked. Million. It lacked in structure. It lacked a lot of action beats. It had a lot of chasing beats.
Right.
Because it's people running all the time, but there's never any moments of. It's the same repetitive action.
Right.
So you're like, I got it. You ran. And what we needed was a little bit of a.
But you had to have that. But here's one thing I do respect about the film, is that no one's a superhero in this. They didn't turn the four guys into someone who can, you know. Cuba Gooding Jr. can kind of fight. I mean, they try to allude that Emilio Estevez was a badass too and can kind of fight. And I agree. I like Emilio, and I'm with you. I don't always see him as a hero type, but
nah.
Especially in this film, which is okay. And they're not. They're getting their asses kicked. They're running a lot. Cuba Gooding Jr. cannot shoot a gun, which is perfect because I mean, most people in that situation they can't shoot a gun.
Right. I think the issue
it's very realistic for me.
That's maybe the issue though.
Right.
Maybe that's part of the problem with the movie is that it borderlined on too real versus. The fantasy of what the situation
right.
would
just
be.
They're just going to be, a good mix. Just yeah. a good, I like, I mean, you know, they throw Jerry Pimmon off the river. I buy that. That happened.
100%.
And it's just, but the more Dennis Leary kept doing stuff, the more he just made it worse for himself.
Yeah.
It's like, you're just making more witnesses that you can kill. It's like, then you break the rule. You established a rule. Why do you keep breaking the rule to, and then they're like, there's a lot of tension on the outside. There didn't need to be an internal tension from the group, especially after Jerry, because Jerry Piven is basically all tension from the group. He's the one who refuses to make the phone call because he says that there's no service. He's the one who is more worried about the RV than anyone else. And all
right, he has financial stakes.
Yeah, he's got stakes involved, yeah. and Emilio has his wife and kid, but that Dennis Leary threatens a little bit, but doesn't go double down. See, if I'm Dennis Leary, I'm just going over there.
Yeah,
you've got to come home sooner or later.
Yeah,
I'll get you when I get you.
Yeah,
and I'll take out the family too, and no one knows me because no one knows who the hell I am.
Right,
because clearly, I mean, there's so many ways this could. It's just I don't know. I'm curious about the cult stash too. I just don't know.
Yeah. I think it's. I mean, I think it all has to do with
But if you're
soundtrack.
A fan, let us know that you're a fan. I'd like to know what makes this movie outside of the soundtrack. I mean, if you love it for the soundtrack, that's great.
I
mean,
yeah, but I would like to know too.
Singles.
Yeah, shoot
literally,
over.
That's why I own singles is because I like the soundtrack and it's like the movie's okay, yeah. But Eddie Vedder's in it too, so whatever. And he gets a line.
Yeah, there you go.
So, I said, it's better than Nemesis, but I don't think anything will. God, I hope nothing else we watch is as bad as Nemesis. Nemesis is so. Weird though,
it's a bizarre film.
It's a real bizarre film. It's like they're.
In some ways, though, it's so painful to get through because it is so bizarre. Unlike this, that's just like you said, it's moderate. It's just right down the line.
It's just very mediocre.
And for me, it ticks into the I'm okay with it box versus yours. I think yours ticks in the not so much box. But we're both in that middle bracket.
Right.
Nemesis, we're both on the farthest end of the spectrum of shit show.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, at least you had quality actors. And there's a story in this. There's no story in Nemesis.
No, there's nothing.
Remember, we had to read the Wikipedia because I didn't know what the hell was going on. Yeah, I mean, I write our synopsises.
Right.
And I tried for Nemesis, and I'm like, I don't know what the hell I just watched. And that's rarely for me. I'm like, I'm on top of this.
But you got to dig to find them turds sometimes.
Oh, man. Yeah. It's just, that's great. But again, I think this movie is just extremely mediocre. And that's all right. I'm like, that's just, like 2 out of 4 stars, 5 out of 10. I mean, literally, it's just like
50%. I'm at 5.5 or 4.4, 2.5.
Right. I'm just like, I was expecting way more than I got out of it.
Yeah.
And that's kind of a shame, because I think there's an interesting film in there. I mean, that's what I like about our show. We take these movies, and some have been better than others, but we always try to go, what could we do with it?
I think you and I
pitch better.
Recalling Demon Knight is fantastic.
Right.
Like, I forgot how much I enjoyed that movie.
Oh, yeah.
So, like, if you don't go through them and cycle them through, you don't know where it is. And look, you watch your own movies. Disagree with us. Like, that's the best part. Is I'd love it if somebody would watch these. Now, look, I love Judgment Night, and here's the reasons why.
Yeah, I'd love to know why.
That's the great conversation about film that needs to be had.
Right.
That's been lost, and it's going away. Why aren't we having? That's what we need to be having.
Yeah, because it's like you. Oh, you don't like the movie. Well, you're a terrible human being. Or you like the movie, you're a terrible human being. What's wrong with you? And I'm of the opinion you like what you like. You can't help that. You enjoyed it. But for me as a fan, I'm like, as a fan of film, I'm just like, I don't see it. Let me know what you saw in it. Yeah. I want to know.
I'm with you on that.
I'm curious about it because, I mean, I'm clearly, I did not see it in the same light.
Yeah, I'm 100% with you on it.
So on the next episode of, I guess it'll come out the same week. Or maybe the week before, because anyway, the episode of the cult movie Cantina that happens around this when we release this is Stephanie's running it instead of me, and Justina's playing her part, so she'll be doing the libation. So I'm playing Justina because I've not seen the movie.
Oh,
and the movie is A Christmas Story.
Oh, that's so wild to me. You've never seen A Christmas Story.
Right, which is like, and so when I leave here, I think I'm going to watch it. I know that I'm going to watch it in the morning because I bought it on Blu-ray when it was on. I found it on Blu-ray at Walmart's Black Friday sale.
Yeah.
So I've never seen it. And so I'm curious how that's going to work out, because I know just enough to be dangerous with it, but I don't. I'm
the best fun fact you can plug in there. You know that he directed, the same director did Black Friday.
Black Christmas.
Black Christmas, which not the remake, the original. The original is fantastic.
Yeah, the original one. Without that, we don't get Halloween.
Yeah.
But so Steph's running all that stuff. I'm curious what's the fun facts of Steph. I'm literally not doing. I'm watching a movie and coming in with notes.
Love it.
It's because I never get to do that. I always have the notes.
Yeah,
I'm always. It's gonna be real hard.
I think it'll be fun. It'll be good for you too.
It'll be real hard not to do research. I mean, when I did it for Whippet, and it just took me for. I was like, I can't do research, and this sucks. But I liked Whippet.
I love A Christmas Story. I'm a fan of that movie. I love the construction of the film. I love the narrative. I love the flow.
Right.
I love the way it looks.
I enjoyed it.
So, as you get there.
I know we're going to invite you for Cult Movie Cantina for a movie that I think it would be a great companion to Nemesis that Steph wants to do.
Okay.
She wants to do Cyborg.
Holy crap, the Jean-Claude movie?
Yeah.
And that's our boy.
That's our boy. That's our Nemesis.
Same director.
Same director. So I want to have you on for...
I will 100% jump in.
And we're going to do that much sooner. We also had our winner for... the contest for the Chronicle of Limbo, Richard Harris won.
Oh, congrats. I love Richard.
And he picked his movie.
Well, do we get to know?
I'll tell you in this show, because the listenerships are different, I think, a little bit. And I guess next week we'll announce that one, too, for that one. But I'll announce it. Go ahead and announce it now. Steph hates this movie. I think this is great.
Oh, no. I know what this is.
She hates this movie.
Yeah.
I love this movie. I think Justine has actually seen it, so it's gonna be interesting. Princess Bride.
I love that movie.
I do too. I'm much like this. If you like this movie, that's great. I don't understand how you hate the Princess Bride.
I don't get how you. I don't know.
I don't know how you hate the Princess Bride. I don't know how you hate the Princess Bride.
Unless maybe you hate Fred Savage. If you hate Fred Savage, write in and let us know.
Yeah, I don't know.
And tell me why. Because remember that show Working he was on? That was a great show.
Yeah.
Not to pull some random thing out of my arse here, but I enjoyed that show.
I want to plug something before we go, and then I'm going to ask suggestions for our next film. But have you seen the movies that made us on Netflix?
Of course. I love it.
I've seen the first two. I've seen Dirty Dancing.
Yeah.
The first one's on Dirty Dancing. I'm not a fan of Dirty Dancing.
Tell me that wasn't a great story, though.
The documentary on Dirty Dancing, I'm like, okay, I see Dirty Dancing in a whole different light now. Yep. I get it.
And total indie film. Beautiful.
However, the one on Home Alone,
it's mind-blowing.
Blew my mind. And I highly recommend it. It's, you know, the holiday season. You know, first, Home Alone's the highest grossing holiday movie of all time. And then how they made it is crazy.
Yeah, shot by a guy who'd never shot a film before.
Yeah,
shot
a feature before, yeah. And also wrote Crazy Gremlins. But shot like in a gymnasium in a school. They built the
insane. And it is like, so good.
And
then Die Hard's fascinating when you get to it.
I can't wait to get to Die Hard.
So I mean, there's some crazy facts.
So what they're doing, it's Dirty Dancing, Home Alone, Ghostbusters, and Die Hard.
Ghostbusters is good. I liked it.
I know a lot about Ghostbusters.
So like, but the relationship part, kind of talking about some things that happened between people at the end of some other people's lives, right, was actually really good.
So speaking of Ghostbusters, long ago, I didn't like it.
Are you going to the trailer?
Yeah, let's talk about the trailer.
I didn't get it. It wasn't for me. And here's the thing. I'm a Ghostbusters fan. I'm not a Die Hard fan. I'm not anti the women Ghostbusters. I actually didn't see it. It just didn't appeal to me. I like Ghostbusters for the nostalgia part of it, but my wife, that's her movie.
Right.
I saw this trailer. It just didn't connect with it. It doesn't look bad. It was mediocre for me. It visually, the way it physically looked is gorgeous. I love it. The story felt like Stranger Things, and I think it's because that kid's in it.
Yeah, he's in a lot of stuff. Every time he shows up in something, I'm like,
it hurts me a little bit because it's easy for me to box him in, but that's where it was.
I liked the trailer more, the teaser more than I thought I was going to like it.
Yeah.
I am amused / horrified that children have nuclear proton packs and just firing weapons like
facts
that throughout the city, and they're like, really, are we doing this? Is it okay? Someone mentioned that they couldn't believe that Ray would give up the Ecto-1 for Spengler to like kind of store, because yeah, that's all about Spengler's family, which I think is great.
It's a cool concept,
the best concept I think to do. Yeah. And they were like, there's no way Ray would give that up. And then I had to remind them that everyone's seen the first Ghostbusters, right?
Yep.
He mortgages his house his childhood home twice. And the interest rate alone was going to be killed. I did the math one day on that. If we ever go back and do Ghostbusters, one of the shows, I need to go back and do that. But I did the math on how much loan.
Oh, it's like ridiculous.
Ridiculous. And like, so, yeah. And then of course it fails.
Right.
Because, you know, Ghostbusters 1 ends and the city doesn't reimburse them or anything. We find out Ghostbusters 2. So he lost his house. And so he ain't got the money to go hold on to Ecto-1. There's no way.
Right.
Ray's occult shop did not couldn't have made that much money.
That's right.
And I'm pretty sure that after they saved the world from Vigo 2 and 2, they didn't get reimbursed either, because, you know, it's in New York.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, it's what it is.
Yeah.
So sorry about that. Sarcoidosis. I'm trying to think of another trailer that come out of that. So you see Nolan's new one, Tenet?
Yeah, it's interesting.
I have no idea what it's about.
Yeah, there's like forward time, backward time.
Whatever. Just you've got my money.
Yeah, I mean, I'll see it. I see his stuff. The movie I'm so still, and it's not ever going to be on this podcast unless it's super terrible, is 1917. I'm kind of excited about that movie.
I want to be, but the more I say, the less I am. So yeah. I'll see it, but I'm not.
It's just a real time thing.
Yeah, I get it. From like, I think it's going to be interesting, but it's like,
I know.
I hope it's...
I'm going in as a fan of the technicians,
right?
See, not a fan of the story.
Right. It's because, like, Sam Mendes is like, I like... I don't like Skyfall.
Yeah, I don't like it, no.
Like, the only Bond I like, really, well, the modern Bond, I like Casino Royale.
I'm the same way. The other ones, they don't do anything
right
for me.
The reason why Casino Royale works is written by three different people, and they each do an act, and it works. The rest of them are just, like, garbage.
Yeah.
Spectre,
I'm not a fan.
Especially Spectre, and the new one looks like garbage.
That's another trailer. I have no appeal. It appeals to me zero.
No, it looks like garbage.
No interest in it whatsoever. Unless he passes the torch, then I'm in.
And then I like, I'm curious about the Road to Victoria. Radcliffe. What's his? Harry Potter.
Yeah.
Daniel Radcliffe. That one looks really interesting. Yeah. And we saw, but.
We got a poster for Villeneuve's Dune.
Oh, really?
Yep.
Oh, that's cool.
Yep. Some key art came out for that.
I'd like to see that.
I'm interested. Look, Denis Villeneuve, I'm not a big fan of Blade Runner 2049.
I didn't see it.
Narratively, it's terrible. Visually, unbelievable. It's Roger Deakins.
Right. Okay. So I'm
won an Oscar for it.
I'm in a camp of people who hate Blade Runner.
I don't hate Blade Runner. I enjoy it. It's just not my favorite science fiction film of all time.
Like, I get Blade Runner. Like, I like Citizen Kane. I don't love Citizen Kane, but I understand Citizen Kane's place in history.
Right.
Blade Runner, I don't like it at all. I don't like it. It's slow. It doesn't, like, the sci-fi is there. I don't care. I just, by the end of it, I just don't care. I don't care if Decker's a robot or not. I just don't. Whatever. However, visually, the mise-en scene in it is, oh, my God.
Oh, it's beautiful.
So pretty to look
at. It's beautiful.
But can it keep my attention for the entire film? It doesn't. I've seen it. I think I've seen every one of the cuts now and hoping that they get better, and they never do.
So, it's slow, and so is 2049.
And that's why I didn't see the new one. It just, like, yeah. Like, I was excited for a minute because, again, it looks stunning, but it's like, and I may pick it up if it's on, like, you know, somewhere streaming.
Oh, yeah, it's worth just to fast forward through.
Right. If it's,
put on a really good soundtrack and watch it, because it's visually just candy.
Right.
But it just didn't.
He did The Arrival, too, didn't he?
Now, see, I love Arrival.
I'm sorry with The Arrival.
I loved it, I liked the way it looked.
I like.
He did Sicario, which is my jam.
Oh, I love Sicario.
I'm about to watch Sicario 2 tonight.
Have you seen it?
No, I've not seen
it. That's good. It's different, but it's good.
Yeah.
See, I like the writer of that. I like all three of his. It's Sicario and Hell and High Water and.
The new one.
The one with Jeremy Renner.
That one was great. Whatever, yeah. the where he goes on the reserve.
Yeah.
That was good.
Oh, yeah.
Wind. Yeah, not Wind Talkers. I don't know. That was a great movie.
Hell High Water is really good, too.
It is. I found the pacing a little weird in spots.
I'm okay,
like,
with it, though.
Yeah.
I'm okay with
it. I mean, it's slow burn Western. I mean,
but it's like the best bank robbery story I've seen in a while.
Yeah.
I mean, really. And it's good from two perspectives.
Yeah.
So I dug it. I think I like it. But Sicario. Oh, my God. I love Sicario.
I love Sicario. It's great.
I just bought it recently, just because
that's Deakins.
I had two. I had two for a minute, and then I was like, I don't own the first one. It was on sale on Amazon Prime, so I was like, it's mine.
Yeah.
So
it's a good movie.
Yeah. That opening when you got the bodies hiding in the walls, and then they go, the cops go out and they're investigating the shed, and then they just blow up. You don't see that shit coming out of nowhere.
Yeah, it's good.
And then you've got Josh Brolin, who's like amazingly asshole-ish in this.
Yep.
And so in two, you've got him doing the same thing, but he's balls to the wall because he's got the Patriot guy on his time. And so it's that guy with no limit.
Yeah.
And it's Benicio del Toro is really good. It's in the trailer, but he shoots a gun stupid.
I love it.
With a weird.
I don't care. I love it.
It doesn't make no sense to me. Like, how's that feasible? But
it's basically modern quick draw.
Yeah, but
he's fanning the back.
Yeah, I don't know.
That's why I love it. I don't care. I'll weird. Have to see it in context. But
yeah, but you'll watch it and be like.
I saw that in the trailer and I squeed. I literally was like, squee. Yeah.
So what do you want to watch next?
How about we mix it up, or you can pick, or I would like to throw out the movie Robot Jocks.
You know what I was thinking?
Yeah.
I was thinking Robot Jocks.
Were you really?
I sure was.
See, we're in synergy, baby.
I was going to think Robot Jocks. Let's
get in this thing and kick its ass.
I love Robot Jocks. Robot Jocks is so good.
I can't wait.
Robot Jocks. No spoilers, but it holds up.
I think it does.
I think it holds up in a bad way, and I've got ways I want to fix it. But and it's Stuart Gordon, and that's a classic, and it's so practical. So we'll do Robot Jocks. We'll start the new year right with Robot Jocks.
Yeah. I love it.
Since we're at the end of the year on this stuff, this is our last podcast of 2019 of our great show we just started. This is episode 6, I think.
6, yeah.
6 of this, so it's not bad for our first little half season there. What are some things would you like to do in 2020?
Oh, man. I'd like to do Demolition Man, and I want to see if we can get David to talk to us about it.
That'd be cool.
I can reach out to him. He's done it before for me. I'd like to do Demo Man. I'd like to tackle some more canon movies, so either Delta Force or American Ninja, something terrible that we can go back and revisit, just because those were part of my Gymkhana childhood.
I would love to offer up Firewalker.
Firewalker, I'm all in on. I haven't seen that movie in a long time, so it'll be good
recently.
For me.
It's funny, but Chuck Norris and Lou Gossett Jr.
Love it.
In a canon film that I'm like, deserved a sequel.
Yeah. I'd rather do that than Alan Quartermain, even though they're bad.
They're bad, but maybe in a future.
But it's got Sharon Stone.
Yeah, Sharon Stone and
Richard Chamberlain.
Richard Chamberlain, who's not bad in it.
No, the acting's fine in them. It's just dumb movies.
There's no money because it's a canon film.
But, yeah. So I'm with Firewalker. And then what about, we went back in Fire, not just how my brain works. We talked about Firestarter. Are you putting that on the other show?
No, I'd do Firestarter on this one. Cause
I'd like to do that because I haven't seen that in a while either.
Yeah, they're developing that for a film.
Well, that's a nice tie-in flip
over. Yeah, we can do it. We can do it.
Robot Jocks, we said we're doing that. That's going to be our first for 20.
I'd also like to order, offer. I want to do a month where we do like vehicle movies. And I would love to do Warlords of the 21st Century / Battle Truck, whichever one you know the title from.
Yes.
I know it is Warlords of the 21st Century, and I have it. And then I also would like to do Damnation Alley.
Ooh, I've never even seen that.
Oh, we're doing Damnation Alley sooner than later. Damnation Alley, 1977, came out right before Star Wars, or came out the summer of Star Wars. It's got George Papard.
Oh, sweet.
It's got him. It's got Jackie Earle Haley is in it. Paul Winfield. Who else am I thinking about? There's a bunch of people. It's got a pretty solid cast. Nuclear war happens and screws up the Earth and knocks us off its axis. And so this Air Force base in the West builds these two basically super RVs to go travel to Albany to find survivors.
And it's
Gene Michael Vincent, who we just lost, he's in it.
Oh, sweet. Stringfellow Hawk.
Yep, Stringfellow Hawk.
Yeah.
And so it's got like, the practical effects are like classic plastic. There's like giant insects basically where the camera's really close to the bug and they have whatever special effect they have.
No way.
Yeah, it's classic. It's classic. Paul Winfield's eaten by roaches. It's just.
I'm in. Let's do it.
It's a good. It's
can soft. We in the same? What about Blue Thunder? Is that too serious?
Blue Thunder. That can run.
That's a dense movie, though.
It is a dense movie. Speaking of dense films, and I don't think this would fly on cult, but I would love to have a real interesting discussion about 2010, the year we made Contact.
Oh boy. Those are tough for me.
Really?
I'll do it.
I like it better
than I'll do it for the show because I like the show and I want to have the conversation.
Yeah. I like it better than 2001 and I want to defend it.
The problem is I hate 2001. We gotta find somebody that's a 2001 fan.
See, I don't like 2001 at all.
I don't either, but I'm not a Kubrick fan.
I'm not a Kubrick fan either.
I like The Shining, but that's his least favorite movie.
I like Full Metal Jacket.
I like Full Metal Jacket. I like The Killing.
But see, Full Metal Jacket, I like it. I like the second part better than the first. Everyone likes the...
No,
the,
I like the second part better.
Everyone except us likes the...
Yeah.
I get the training stuff. That's interesting. But the real story is when they're in Vietnam. It's how they react to that stuff. Joker in Vietnam is... Cowboy, he runs in with Rafterman. It's a good story.
I just like seeing Jane, what is his name? Adam Baldwin.
Yeah, Adam Baldwin.
And he didn't even know what he was doing. Animal Mother. He has animal no mother. Idea what he's doing.
Right.
No clue.
Right.
In a Kubrick film. And like I heard an interview and I talked to him about a Dragon Con one year. I was like, dude, look, you're in a Kubrick film. Like we can talk about Firefly or we can talk about Kubrick. He was like, let's talk about Kubrick.
Right.
And so you get these great stories from him about it. He has no clue what he's doing. He's like, I didn't know what it was going to be, He's cemented into cinema history.
Right.
It's crazy. I mean, we'll do it. We just got to find somebody to argue 2001 with you. Or I got to watch them both, and that's tough.
No, don't watch them both. 2010 is one of my favorite movies.
Yeah.
I saw it at a young age, like back when my folks were into me, all kinds of sci-fi stuff, and I just fell in love with it. The whole thing. And Roy Snyder's in it, and he's fucking great in it.
Yeah.
John Lithgow is amazing in the movie. It's got Helen Mirren. It's got great, solid cast.
Yeah.
But later on, maybe the summer we'll do.
Okay.
2010.
I'll do it.
Because it's the year we made Contact.
Yeah. I'm all for it.
And it's 10 years after the fact that we made Contact, but, almost 44, almost gonna be 36 years or whenever it come out. So
that's crazy.
Isn't it crazy?
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
So we're there. We got some fun stuff to do.
I'm all about it. Let's do it.
We'll do it. All right.
And then I think, you know, whatever viewers, if viewers want to.
Guys, you know, you can find us.
Jump on and throw us the stuff.
The Cult Movie Cantina, that's where we hang out too. So you can, whatever you want us to do. And we like to do weird stuff. The weirder, the better. We're always looking for something bizarre.
Yeah, throw it in.
And so we're happy to do it.
And we'll rotate some guests in and out too.
Yeah, we're going to rotate some guests in and we're going to do some live shows too, but on both this and Cult. So you've seen us at conventions and some other places. I'm working on live shows this year. That's the big. We had so much fun on our last one, and people have been requesting us to do live again. So we're gonna do some more.
Good stuff.
All right. Well, that's better than I can say about Judgment Night.
Yeah. Yeah. In fact, I guess the only thing left is Happy Holidays.
Happy Holidays. Yeah.
And we'll see you in the new year.
This is Scotty saying this is our contribution to the multiverse. Go out and make yours.
Kohos out.
Thank you for listening to the Mobcast Network.